Hello, people of the world. We're back here in the Acoustic A Room at South Austin Music. You got the world's worst interviewer right here, sitting next to my longtime friend, David Grissom. A long time, I officially met him a couple minutes ago.
Yeah.
So it's going to be a good
time. We go way back.
Yeah, way back. You know, out there in the by the pedal counter.
That's right.
It was good times. So yeah, David here, you've been a guitar player for what, like at least a century?
I picked it up a couple of weeks ago, and I came to South Austin Music and took some lessons in within 2 weeks. I was like, I was making a living at it.
Yeah, started doing world tours, right?
Yeah.
In all seriousness, you have traveled the world playing guitar, have you not?
I have,
okay,
yeah.
Cool. So you played with some big names like Dixie Chicks, David Grissom's a big name you played with.
Yeah, he's okay.
Okay, sweet. So yeah, I got a list of names here, and I wanted to ask you, like, which one did you have the most fun playing with or felt the most natural? Or, and, you know, don't be afraid of hurting feelings because they're all musicians. Their feelings are hurt anyway.
Well, I don't kiss and tell.
Okay. I'll keep
it on the up and up.
Okay, sweet. So we got Joe Ely here. We have John Mellencamp, Storyville, Dixie Chicks, and David Grissom. Which ones did you maybe have the most fun playing with there?
The most fun would be definitely, I mean, ultimately at the end of the day, my gig.
Yeah.
Like next door.
Yeah.
Even if there's only 50 people in there, that to me has sort of been the. At this point in my life, that's where I am right now. But I get to, you know, I get to do my thing, and it's such a different experience when it's your band and it's my songs, and as opposed to being a side man, which the bulk of my life was, I was playing guitar for other people on their songs.
Right.
Except for Storyville, I was part of that band. But in terms, you know, so I would have to say that what I'm doing right now is incredibly rewarding in its own way. But I would not be able to do that if it wasn't for the sideman gigs that I had before.
Right.
And of all those, each one of them, every session I've been on, every gig I've played has taught me things that allow me to do what I do now. And going back to Joe Ely, I mean, you know, well, I mean, the first really gig I got in Austin was Lucinda Williams before she was Lucinda Williams. And within, you know, 2 weeks of getting that gig, I was in a car on the way to New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Festival. And I mean, I'd only been here for a couple of months. And I grew up in Kentucky, beautiful place, but Austin at that time was like the magic kingdom.
Yeah.
And so to like be in a car driving to the New Orleans Jazz and Heritage Festival and having that experience, being there, staying in the French Quarter, a modest hotel, but in that hotel at the same time was Roy Orbison, Grandmaster Flash, and Richard Thompson. We're all hanging by the pool together. And I'm thinking, life is really good. So that and then from there, you know, I got in Louann Barton's band and I was playing at Antone's all the time. And that was like I was there every night.
Yeah, Antone's is another iconic.
It was like, man, you know, one night Otis Rush, the next night Albert Collins. I mean, it was like amazing. And I got to play there a lot and learned so much. And after that, for the next 5 years, I played with Joe Ely. And that was as much fun as it's legal to be in a band. I mean, it was amazingly fun.
Yeah.
And that gig really is, I think, is where I became a musician.
Right.
I mean, I got.
How long had you been playing before that?
Well, I've been playing a while, you know, but I mean, I'm talking about like a next level, like, all right.
You came into yourself. You felt
I think I found my voice. I think I found my voice, and
your
it was really because of Joe and the way he ran his band, his artistic integrity, and the opportunity he gave me just like, you know, step out on the edge of the stage and go. I mean, like long guitar solos, you know, and so the whole idea of playing with dynamics and great songwriting and his vision of the choices. I watched the choices he made in career-wise and, you know, kind of weren't the typical choices. I mean, he never took like the immediate, you know, I'm going to be the Texas Bruce Springsteen route, which was presented to him several times. He was like, I'm staying true to myself, and I want to do this for the rest of my life.
Yeah,
and
you got to do what you do. Like, yeah. What you really want to do, or else it's not going to feel as fulfilling.
Yeah, and so consequently, he has a vibrant career to this day, and that really made an impression on me, you know, like the way he made decisions. And so that was a blast.
Yeah.
Working with Mellencamp was, an amazing opportunity as well. I mean, I went from playing clubs to arenas and watching him work in the studio. It wasn't always fun, but it was a great experience.
Yeah, and what's the biggest crowd you played for, could you say?
The biggest crowd, my whole life?
Yeah.
The biggest crowd?
Like, biggest venue you did.
The biggest crowd I ever played for, I know where it was.
Besides this one with our 5 million viewers.
Yeah. Hey, everybody. The 4th of July in about 1986,
okay,
with Joe Ely, we played in Philadelphia at the foot of wherever it was that Rocky ran up the steps, you know.
The
library or the museum, I don't know. But we played there, and it was us, the Neville Brothers, the Beach Boys, featuring special guests Jimmy Page and Mr. T.
Holy.
So how do you make that? How did they come up with Mr. T and Jimmy Page? I got my picture with Mr. T that day, but no, there were like a million people out there.
No
apparently,
kidding.
Yeah. You could, as far as you could see.
That's crazy.
I mean, like as far as you could see were people, and they had PA towers like every.
Yeah. Did you 50, get nervous 50 back yards. In those days?
Back no, I was like back then. I hardly ever got nervous.
Yeah. Never. No butterflies. Nothing.
Not really. Not with Ely.
Yeah.
When I got with John's band, there were a couple of times it was like, because he was so, like if you play one wrong note, he was on you.
Really?
It was like, you know, there's a pretty high pressure situation.
It seems like a lot of musicians, I guess you have to be, but it seems like a lot of successful musicians like tend to be kind of perfectionists, right? Would you view yourself as one of those?
No.
No?
No. I mean, I have like a high standard.
Yeah.
But I kind of, one thing that John taught me was that we'd be making a record and we'd cut a song and there would be something that I would feel like I had to do over. Mm-hmm. And he was like, no, man, no, it's great the way it is. And like a week later, I would listen to whatever it was I thought I had to do. I would go back and say, I would ask like the assistant engineer, play that for me, and I want to make sure I don't need to do that over. And I would listen to it, and I'm like, I couldn't find the spot.
Yeah.
You know, and so there's like it's this trade-off of being of perfection and then emotion, and I try to lean towards the vibe and the energy and the groove of it all. But I mean, when you're doing, it depends what the situation is. If I'm playing on a record for somebody or doing a session. In session world, you do have to kind of be perfect. I mean,
right.
You know, timing, your tone, your parts, everything has to be impeccable. There's no fudging. That if you try to pull the, it's got a vibe card.
Mm-hmm.
Most producers will say, it might have a vibe, but it doesn't have the vibe I want. I mean, so I did a session for Ringo Starr once.
Okay.
One day I was on the road with Mellencamp. We were in L.A. and I got a call from Kenny Ernoff, says, hey, Don West just called me, wants to know if you can make a session today with Ringo. And I'm like, yeah, I can make that. And so that was surreal.
Drop anything
to do that. Those kind of crazy. And it's not necessarily like the biggest names or whatever, but it's like, mm-hmm, when the music is really meaningful and happening. That's kind of what I live for. I mean, like, you know, making the new James McMurtry record was challenging for various reasons, but when I heard the finished product, I was like, that's top five for me, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, I can go to my grave knowing that record will be here after I'm gone. And, you know, having the opportunity to do sessions and play on great songs,
mm-hmm,
is really like lay guitar parts on great songs.
Yeah.
That's when the meat is on the bone.
For sure.
You know.
Is that like is that kind of like one of your biggest goals with the guitar playing, like since the start, is like have like that one record that stays behind? You know, it's kind of timeless.
Well, I don't really, I mean, yeah, I like making stuff that I mean, the music I love, or a lot of the music I love, I feel is timeless. I mean, right. You know, you can put on any Tom Petty record and it still sounds vibrant. I mean, you know, most, like the first four or five Joni Mitchell records still sound incredible. I mean,
did you draw inspiration from any of those guys?
Yeah.
Yeah, all of them?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I could... We don't have enough time to talk about it. I mean, I've been inspired by, you know, in one way or the other, by almost everyone I've ever worked with.
Like I kind of touched on it earlier, your guitar playing is unique, even to, you know, guys that have been studying guitar playing for years and years. Like some of my coworkers out there, they all say that your style is really unique. And it makes me, like, what's kind of like your background? She's like growing up playing guitar, like, where do you think that kind of came from?
It came from growing up in Kentucky where there wasn't a big scene.
Yeah.
And so you really had to go look for music.
Okay.
And so I was like FM, when I was a kid, I would fall asleep with the radio, like this little tiny AM radio on. And I remember even then, because they played so many different kinds of music and there were certain songs and certain bands and there was like these sounds, you know, the records that had a sound that really appealed to me.
For sure.
But like my dad played a lot of country music around the house. And so like I would hear like a Waylon Jennings record and there's a song called Only Daddy That'll Walk the Line where Wayne Moss played this guitar solo in it. Just like that one guitar solo captivated me. And then I heard the Allman Brothers and then I found out about, so I'm listening to Duane Allman and then I went, you know, actually I got to B.B. King before I got to the Allman Brothers, which is crazy. And you know, it would just be these. And then a lot of bluegrass going on around Kentucky.
Yeah. So
and
just all those different styles kind of culminating.
Yeah, and the beauty of it was there wasn't any internet when I was in high school.
Right.
And it wasn't like, there weren't like forums or 1,000 people telling everyone what was cool. And if you like this, you're not cool. And if you like that, then you're a loser. And, you know, it's like, it was just like, And the few musicians that I played with, we were all kind of the same thing. I mean, I found a George Benson record where I picked up all these things from. And then there was one, I remember like a Crusaders record that had this Larry Carlton solo on one song. And it was just like, the rest of the record really didn't do that much for me, but it was one solo.
Was
and so now we're just like inundated with so many things. So that back then, you find one thing and I would learn it, you know, and I would, there was no tab. There was no YouTube where you could just go like Google the song and somebody would show you how to play it. It was, you know, you had to develop your ear. And then again, it was just, nobody was sitting there telling me, you can't play a Norman Blake lick in a blues rock song.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I was like, I listened to some of my stuff, even though the guitars are like pretty overdriven and heavy, and I hear the whole bluegrass thing come through.
Do you think people playing guitar and learning how to play guitar, you know, back when you were doing it, do you think they might have like an easier time, or they were at an advantage rather than nowadays where it's like you said, you go on YouTube, you can Google how to play this song, and everyone's going to tell you exactly how to do it, and there's kind of more guidelines.
I see it as an advantage. Whole everything I just said about not having the whole universe of, and a lot of, you know, I would wager that a lot of the people that are putting out all this information quotes have never played a gig.
Yeah,
and. You know, there was no American Idol shortcut.
Mm-hmm.
It was just like, get behind the chicken wire and play, man.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that was really it. I took every gig. I played in VFWs and bars that, like, if I didn't have a guitar in my hand, I wouldn't be going in there, you know? I mean, it was like you learn intangible things. I got gigs in Austin and in other places because I went out every single night.
Right.
I mean, you got to be out. You got to be in the scene.
Was it purely the music scene that made you want to like put down your roots in Austin?
That's what got me down here. But then when I got down here, it was the whole scene. I mean, it was a completely different town than it is now. I still love Austin, and every time I entertain the idea of moving somewhere else, I
can't.
That didn't last.
Yeah.
That thought leaves my mind pretty quickly. But
if you were getting kicked out, like had to go, where would you go?
Good question.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, Nashville is the obvious place, but it's not. It's. I'm not sure what I would do there, to be frank.
Yeah.
I mean, there's so many great players and great younger players that will work a lot cheaper.
Right.
And it's a whole new crop of producers than I used to work with. That, you know, it's hard to say. This is home.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Home to a lot of musicians. Has been for a while, but it's like you're saying, it's changing a lot. It's, I don't know, it's interesting. You see like a lot more DJs on Dirty Six now, whereas you used to see a lot of live music.
Yeah.
You know, playing guitar and stuff.
Yeah.
Do you feel a certain way about that, or is it just the way things are?
It's just the way things are. I mean, you know, if I start bemoaning the loss of the fact that there aren't as many blues clubs here, it's like, you know, there's a generational shift. It's always gone back to that. I mean, if you look back, you know, God, if you were in big bands, if that's what you did, like overnight, there were no big bands.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, so it's just things change.
Yeah. And you have to be able to adapt with the changes too.
Or do something else if you don't like it. I mean, you know, I'm just not like really into the whole idea of bemoaning the way it used to be, because it's never come. That's not coming back. So get on with it. But it makes me appreciate the things, you know, that there are still things here in Austin that remind me of the way it was when I first got here. And
what are some of those things? Could you put your finger on them?
Yeah, I can put my finger on them because there's not that many of them. Like where we're sitting right now.
Yeah.
You know, this store and the club next door are like, you know, you can just go outside and stand in the front and look up and you can see all the sky, you know, the towers and the condos and everything coming in around them. It's like in out the broken spoke. It's like the last remnants of the cool stuff.
They're hanging on, dude. They're hanging on.
But, you know, now, I mean, I used to, because when I got here, I mean, like, my day was sleep till noon and either go to Barton Springs or go down to Ray Hennig's Heart of Texas Music and just hang out.
Yeah.
And everybody hung out there.
Yeah.
That was like the epicenter of, like, that's what musicians did during the day. And, you know, we'd hang out and trade licks, talk guitars. And there were like vintage guitars coming in all the time. It was like, you know, and they would let you put stuff on account. That was their thing.
Right.
You want to just put it on your account?
Yeah.
Well, sure. And, but that was like, that was sort of like this community. Uh-huh. And now South Austin music has sort of taken that role.
Yeah.
You know,
absolutely.
Of, you know, nothing against Guitar Center, but that's a whole nother vibe.
Mm-hmm.
And then, I can walk in here and talk to any of the guys or Bill, and it's like, what's cool, what's new?
Yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
I want to sell this, can you help me out? And it's like, yeah, I mean, it's so the fact that your neck, that this store is next door to the place I play every Tuesday is, you know, it's like
Works out pretty well. The
double whammy.
And
I can't think of another music store in town. You know, Austin Vintage is cool, but that's a whole nother thing, and it's up north. But, you know, this is sort of what Ray Hennig's used to be. This is kind of this is the equivalent now, and I always run into somebody I know here.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's awesome. How many guitars do you think you've gone through in your time playing? You have any idea?
No idea.
Over 100?
You mean that I've owned and got rid of?
Yeah,
and probably.
Yeah, over 100.
Probably.
Is there one you wish you still had that you sold?
There are a couple of them. There are like a couple come to mind that are painful to think about. But you know what? The funny thing is about selling guitars is it's like the minute you sell them, they get better.
Yeah.
In your mind, you know, it's like, God, why did I sell that thing? It was so incredible. The whole time you've got it, you're not playing it. You know, it's like, it's a funny phenomenon that, you know, it's not lost on me. I traded this vintage guitar recently to get another guitar. And then like 4 days later, the dealer I traded to sold it to Norm's Rare Guitars, and it was the guitar. I was just cruising through Instagram. It was the guitar of the day, and they were going on, and the guy was playing it. I'm looking at it, going, why did I do it? And then I remember, they're selling guitars. I mean, you know, they say it's the greatest one ever about everything, you know. But yeah. You know, it's just, to me, different guitars have song. You know, different, like a guitar can have song. Like all these acoustics here have songs in them. Mm-hmm. And so I might get a certain acoustic and keep it for a year.
Yeah.
And at first it's like floats my boat, and I might actually literally write songs because of that guitar. Mm-hmm. And then a year later it's like, it's not really, I'm ready to, you know, I want to trade it and get something else.
Are there any guitars that have like lasted through the years that you've had?
Yeah.
A few?
Yeah.
Okay.
There are.
Yeah. They're just always stuck with you. There's never something you want to trade it for something else.
Yeah. Yeah, like I arrived here with, I owned one guitar, and it was a 1960 Stratocaster, Fiesta Red Stratocaster, and I bought it in Memphis in 1980 for $400, and...
How much is it worth now, would you say?
It's worth a little more than that. I'd put a couple more zeros on it. But,
yeah.
But I've managed to hang on to it the whole time. And
still no chance you're going to give it up.
No, I mean, if I can find one better, I might think about it. But it sounds, for a slab board Strat that also happens to be a Fiesta Red.
All right, David, it was great talking with you. We like to do this thing where kind of just ask you really fast questions. You give me the quickest answer you can give. You know, not a lot of... Not
is there a time limit?
No. I mean, try and keep it under a second. You know, like, first thing that comes to mind. So, like, you know, for example, I'll start off with boots or tennis shoes?
Boots.
Tacos or hamburgers?
Tacos.
Cowboy hat or no hat?
No hat.
Okay. Jean jacket or coat?
Jean jacket.
Okay. I couldn't guess that one. Huh?
Yeah.
Favorite guitar brand?
Paul Reed Smith.
Yeah, that's a good answer. Gotta keep those guys happy.
Yeah.
T-shirt, long sleeve.
T-shirt.
Boxers or briefs?
Briefs.
We want to get to know you.
I mean, like they're kind of in between ones.
Yeah, like cotton, but it still keeps everything compact.
Yeah. Not the tidy whiteys.
When you're rocking out on stage.
Not the tidy whiteys.
Yeah. Shower or bath?
Shower.
Okay. Manicure or pedicure? Don't lie. We all get them.
I do not get them. cut my own nails.
Okay. Let's see.
Seriously, you get one?
I've done the pedicure before. It was okay. I've done the manicure before, and my mom made me do the pedicure, and they tricked me into getting them painted. I was like, well, I'll just take it off when I get home. But they did just this gel shit. It was like sparkly gel stuff. It doesn't come off with regular nail polish. So for a whole summer of my high school, I had sparkly nails.
Yeah.
I'm still messed up over it.
Yeah, probably.
I haven't talked to my mom since.
See, where I went to high school, you get killed for that. Yeah. I wouldn't be here right now.
Yeah, well, I scraped through, just barely. It was fine. I embraced it. I told everyone it was my idea. I'm stubborn like that.
Good.
Steel string or classical?
Steel string.
Okay. Electric or acoustic?
Both.
Blondes or brunettes? What's your wife?
I like blonde Gibsons. blonde Gibsons, butterscotch Tullys.
There you go. I was talking about guitars too. It's perfect.
Yeah. A 59, like 335 and blonde.
Yeah.
If y'all get one in, let me know.
put it on the wish list, okay? Let's see. What else we got? Telecaster or Strat?
Telecaster.
Okay. Humbuckers or single coil?
How could you? I mean, at the end of the day...
Time's up.
Humbucker if I have to choose.
Yeah, okay. Okay, cool. Yeah, so basically what we were all thinking, we all wanted to know is, you know, someone's starting to play guitar. In modern times, what would be your best advice for them? How would they like get into it? Would they want to go see a teacher, you know, take lessons? Would they want to do self-taught, Google it?
I'm a big proponent of having a teacher.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think, And
you gotta learn from somebody.
And like the danger, the pitfall that we touched on earlier that I see is too much information.
Uh-huh.
And trying to be all things. And so in all seriousness, if you can cut, I mean, I know like I'm older and I spend way too much time cruising through Instagram and everything all day long. So I know that someone who's, you know, 14 or 15 that's like starting out, they're on hours a day.
Yeah.
And so it's like the whole Instagram comparison game is the complete enemy of creativity and imagination. So, you know, I would suggest take that 45 minutes that you were going to be on Instagram, 45 minutes out of the 3 hours that you're normally on Instagram, and practice. And it's the challenge, I think, again, is too much information, whether it's comparing yourself to all these incredible guitar players that can do 60 seconds that will blow your mind, but maybe they can't play a 12-bar blues.
Yeah.
I don't know. So having a teacher, I think, can help you just focus on a few things.
Yeah.
And that's, for me, that was really the key. You know, I would like B.B. King live at the Regal.
Yeah.
I studied it for 2 years. All my brothers at Fillmore East, I studied it. I'm still studying it, you know. I mean, so it's just like we can get so freaked out by all these things that we all want to learn. So I would just suggest get a teacher, keep it simple, and then as soon as possible, play with other people.
Yeah.
Play with other people and learn how to learn. Each situation is different.
Right.
And, you know, pieces of advice I could give are play gigs and turn down when someone else is soloing.
Okay, gotcha.
That's like, you want to like label yourself as an amateur right off the bat, go sit in and don't turn down when somebody else is soloing.
Yeah.
It's like, that's like
rookie moves.
I mean, it seems really like
silly,
but because that sort of encompasses the whole idea of being a team player.
Right, absolutely.
And
if you can't let other people have the spotlight, then.
Yeah. Well, and sounding like a band.
Life's a winding road, bends and bridges, twists and turns. Time's a match in your fingertips, strike it up and watch it burn. Once we found our shelter in the arms of the moonlight glow, too many walks on fences, too many I don't knows, yeah. Wish you peace on the wings of love and anything that you're trying. I hope you find the answers to the questions in your heart. May you be satisfied. Sometimes I feel like crying, sometimes I wanna laugh. Hanging on to your memory like an old faded photograph. So many things I'd tell you if you were still around. I'm sorry that I hurt you, sorry that I let you down. And I wish you peace on the wings of love and anything that you try. Hope you find the answers to the questions in your heart. May you be satisfied. Wish you peace on the wings of love. hope you find the answers to the questions in your heart. May you be satisfied.